welcome you this morning to Camp Creek Church, and oh, what a joy to see you all here. What a blessing it is that we can actually come. We can come together. There are so many things that would keep us away, other places in the world that they can't do this, and I'm just rejoicing. We're going to start with "Come Now is the Time to Worship." We're inviting you to stand, join us. After we sing it through once, I'm going to let you, however you see fit, greet one another. We're here to worship the Lord. What you're going through, we want to proclaim the God's name.
Close in love.
be seated. We're going to finish our opening worship time with that hymn, Trust and Obey. Trust and Obey.
Welcome to Camp Creek this morning. Thank you for coming, being a part of our worship service this morning. For those of you watching online, again, thank you for taking time out of your day to tune in to us. We appreciate that. If those of you that are here would want to pull out your bulletins, we'll just look at some of the things that are happening in the life of the church. We have a mom's group that will meet at the church on the 2nd from 9 to 11. Let's continue to be in prayer for that group of people that meet and the people that deal with child care there. Also, today is the last day to contact Sue. If you have information about the subscription to the messenger, if you want to be on that list or want to be taken off, get a hold of Sue and she can do that for you. Notice that we have some prayer concerns in there and we'll go over some of those later. February birthdays are in there. So happy birthday to all of you that have your name on there in the month of February. A couple weeks from today is Sunday, February 12th, and it is Donut Sunday, again, from 9 to 9:30 in the morning before our Sunday school. There's also a note that next Sunday is Bible memory lessons for those of you that are involved in Bible memory. Tuesday, February 14th, then, is Ladies' Aid in the Fellowship Hall, and again, you see information about that in your bulletin. Is there anything else that anyone has this morning in the way of an announcement that they would like to share with the church? Okay, seeing none, I'm going to invite Jada to come forward, please.
Matthew 5:13, you are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? It is no longer good for anything but to be thrown out and stepped on underfoot. Matthew 5.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jada. We appreciate that very much. Again, you had seen the slide up there about our offerings. And they'll be placed in the box in the back or sent to the church or given online. So thank you for that. So as we go into a time of prayer, you'll notice in your bulletin list of prayer concerns. And thank you for those ladies to put those in there. I appreciate that very much. John, I know, had a successful procedure, and they are staying with David right now because they had a couple appointments, I believe, next week or this upcoming week in Chicago. So they just decided to stay in Valparaiso with David. Janita's home and scheduled for surgery on Tuesday, I believe that is. And so let's continue to be in prayer for her. You see there Anita's sister Betty passed away. Let's remember Amanda's dad as he continues to struggle there. Missy's mom, again, I had talked to Missy this week. She has been moved to a rehab center at this point and was improving slightly. So let's continue to remember Dee, the Cunningham family, and Roger and Stacy. So anyone else have anything that we can add to that list this morning? Okay, let's spend some time in prayer. Great God, we thank you. Thank you for who you are, for being our God. We thank you for this church that you've put together, each one who brings a part to the body. And you say in your word that the body is made up of many parts, each unique, each bringing its own talents and abilities. And Father, you've put us together here at Camp Creek, and we thank you for that and ask that you continue to meet with us, not only this morning, but as we continue to meet on a regular basis. Father, we have a list of concerns here in the bulletin, and we just ask that you would be working in each situation, those that have health concerns, ask that your hand would be on their lives, that you'd be with the doctors and nurses that are dealing with them, those that have lost loved ones, pray that you would continue to watch over them and give them peace and comfort through this time. And Father, we just thank you for Roger and Stacy and ask that you would continue to work in their lives, touch Roger's mind and body, and just continue to give it healing as he works through this time in his life. And we just ask a blessing on that family right now. Father, I pray that you'd be with Dwayne this morning. Continue to lay on his heart words that you want us to hear, and that he'd be a vessel for you and be able to deliver those in a way that would be able to teach us and help us to learn about who you are. And Father, we just, again, thank you so much for your son, who died, who rose again, that we can have eternal life. We worship and praise you this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Some of you may know this about me, others may not, but I'm not a very deep thinker. I don't think very deeply, but I'm a doer, so much so that I would rather do something even if I have to come back later and fix it, because I want to do something. But this worship song this morning talks about the Father's deep, deep love for us, and it forces me to think deeper about what it means and what he did for us. So I would encourage you as we sing this together to think about that deeper meaning and what he's done for us, how deep the Father's love for us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give Turns it.
Okay, those of you involved in Children's Church are dismissed at this time, and we invite Dwayne forward.
Well, good morning.
Good morning, Dwayne.
Happy week.
Yep.
Busy week.
Yep.
Yep.
Well, do me a favor, take a great big deep breath, because it's Sunday today. As we stated before, I do hope that as you see church, a place that you come, because you are tired, because you are spent and exhausted from the previous week, in order to be refreshed, encouraged, to go out and do it all over again. So that is what our prayer and hope is for today, to encourage your hearts to go and continue to do what God has called you to do. Now, the emphasis on this particular section of Scripture seems to be on kind of like a self-deception. One, deceiving our own selves, chapter 1, verse 22. It even talks about deceiving our hearts, and it causes us to maybe say, seriously? I mean, are you kidding me? Are we kidding ourselves? Is kind of the question that kind of would cause us to think. Like this picture right here. My little Oliver. Yes, I had permission to use this. Story behind this is my daughter ordered buck teeth pacifiers to take over. What's funny is, you know, as little infants, they like a specific pacifier and they don't like others. It feels differently in their mouth or whatever the case may be. So what you might put in, it just spits out. This is the one he likes. So it has nothing to do with deceiving ourselves. It's just a cute picture, and I got the clicker, so I got to do it, okay? So, but seriously, are we kidding ourselves? And we're going to be looking at the book of James, chapter 1, verses 19 through 27. But before we do, let's have a word of prayer together. Father God, I want to thank you so much for this day that you've given to us, the opportunity, as was said before, that we get to gather together, that we get to worship, that we get to sing, that we get to fellowship, and even just greet one another, and that is a blessed thing. So, Father, may we never take that for granted. But, Lord, that we would also come before this place with our hearts open and our ears receptive to what it is that you would have for us in the midst of these moments together. Lord, may your word be what is spoken today, and may your word be what rings true and pricks our hearts. Again, for the prayer concerns that we have listed out before us, I pray, God, that you be the one who, again, just reveals himself in all those situations and all those circumstances. And Lord, we are excited and looking forward to seeing the things that you are going to do to glorify your name through each and every one of them. So, Father, we thank you, and we do pray. Amen. Talking about deceiving ourselves and deceiving even our own hearts. If as a believer, we sin because Satan has deceived us, that's one thing. But if we as believers sin because we deceive our own selves, that's a little bit more of a serious issue. I mean, many people are deceiving themselves even into thinking that they are saved. We know that because Matthew chapter 7, verses 22 starts out like this. It says, on that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of evil lawlessness. So one of the ways of deception comes in is we're deceiving ourselves, that there are many deceiving themselves that think they're even saved because they're basing that salvation on what they did or what they do or what they are currently doing. At the same time, many of us believers could be deceiving ourselves in our walk. In our everyday, daily walk. How? Well, it could be by thinking that we are more spiritual than we actually really are. That we're deceiving ourselves in the way that we view ourselves when it comes to spirituality than what we truly are. Because the spiritual reality is that a reflection of a proper relationship with the Lord through His Word should be reflected of our spirituality. Why? Because John 17 says it very clear, God's word is truth. So our relationship with his word, our relationship with him, is going to depend and picture the spirituality in which we have. So as a believer, evaluate our walk can become a needed thing. And that's what we're going to do this morning. James points out three responsibilities that we need to know in order to keep in mind as we go through the Word of God. So what I want to do is read the passage together, James chapter 1, verses 19 to 27. And again, I'll direct you to the journal. There's a few of them back there left if you want one, so we can all kind of be reading the same translation. If not, you know, whatever translation you have. But starting in verse 19 to the end of the chapter, it says this: "So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. For the wrath of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. Because he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it, and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. If anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world." So we're going to look at some responsibilities that James puts out when it comes to the Word of God. First one is this: receiving the Word of God. Verses 19 to 21. To receive the Word of God. James calls the Word of God the engrafted Word, or the implanted Word. It brings to mind the whole gardening aspect and preparing the soil before you plant or engraft seed into the ground. As in the parable that Jesus teaches, James compares God's word to the seed and the heart of the human soil. Matthew chapter 13. Remember the farmer and the seed? The sower and the seed, and there's different types of ground that the seed falls upon? Well, one of those grounds was a hard heart. In other words, they never understood the word. They were hardened to it. They did not receive the word whatsoever. It hit the top of the ground. The sun came out, dried it up. It was done. It was a hard heart. Therefore, no fruit. So when that seed fell upon the hard heart, there was no fruit. That same parable talks about a shallow heart. In other words, it could have been somewhat turned and ready to go, but there was no depth. So maybe something would spring up quickly, but after that quick spring up, with the heat, with the sun, with the lack of water, with the lack of nutrients, with the lack of rooting, what happened to it? It just died away. Therefore, no fruit. It talked about a crowded heart, the lack of repentance and allowing sin to crowd in and out of the Word of God. It would allow the thorns and the thistles and the thickness just to come in and would actually crowd out the seed, take all the nutrients so that the seed would receive none, therefore dying away. And once again, what? No fruit. But then there was a fruitful heart. A heart, a soil that was tilled and ready to go, that received the word, allowing it to take root. And in Matthew 13, it talks about a fruit that was produced even 30 or 60 or 100 times more. And James takes that same aspect of the parable that Jesus was teaching in the book of Matthew and compares it to our hearts. So what is the final test of salvation? How do we know a believer is truly a believer? It's by his fruit. It's his works. It's his changed life. It's his Christ-like character. It's the Christ-like conduct. It's the way that he or she ministers to others and minister others in the glory of God. The evidence of a believer, the evidence of salvation, is the works that the individual does. Keep in mind, we'll talk about it a couple different times, the evidence of salvation is the way you and I as believers work. The basis for our salvation is not our works. Does that make sense? The evidence that we're saved is revealed in our works. Our works is not the basis for our salvation. What is the basis for our salvation? Jesus Christ. The cross. His death. His burial and resurrection. That is the basis for our salvation. He loves us so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That is the basis for our salvation. Because of his love for us, what he did for us, the works in return in love for him is a changed life. His character, his conduct, the way that we minister to others in the glory of God. Now, can these works be manufactured? Absolutely they could. In fact, I could go to any motivational speaker program and I could be a motivational speaker. And I can do so without ever talking about Christ. I can talk to business leaders and what it means to not only lead from an office, but get down with the people. To work hard. Let them see you work. I can use words like servanthood leadership. I can use words like that and not ever bring the principle of the biblical basis behind that in. I can be the motivational speaker. I can do that. Therefore, we can manufacture these works. But when they're manufactured without the basis of salvation, there is no life. We see that very clearly again in Matthew chapter 7. So if the seed of the word is going to be planted in our hearts, a fruitful heart, James leaves us some specific instructions in this passage. One of those is this: quick or swift to hear. Verse 19. Ears to hear, let him hear. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God. A servant is quick to hear his master's voice. We understand that, don't we? A servant is quick to hear his master's voice. A mother is quick to hear the cry of her child. That one amazes me. I can be sound asleep, and any one of the kids is a baby. Oh, perfect example. Just now, this little one just coughed. I mean, ever so slightly. Immediately, I see moms go, "Ooh!" One was my own wife. Why? Because a mother. I mean, I can be sound asleep, deep, deep sleep, and there can be a child crying, or maybe even have a different. And instantly, Charlotte is up, awake, alert, looking to see. That's what it means. Be quick or swift to hear. Just like a servant listens for his master, or just like a mother listens for their child, be swift to hear. Abraham was keen to the hearing of the voice of the Lord. And I'm thankful for that. You know it? But I bet Isaac is all the more thankful. That in the midst of the adrenaline, in the midst of the walking, the hiking, and bounding up his own son to be placed upon the altar, that Abraham was so keen on listening to the voice of the Lord that in the midst of his heart pumping and the knife in his hand about ready to be plummeted to his own son, he heard the voice of the Lord that said, "Stop." You think Abraham was quick to listen? You think Isaac was thankful? Yes. Yes. Quick to listen. Personal example for us. We used to take mission trips. We talked about it a little bit this morning. Just mission trips all over the different place. And some of the ones we would do, we would take a group of guys into like a camp. And we would go off season. Specifically to get these properties ready to go. Painting, rebuilding, tearing down, you name it, raking, gravel, hauling. There was nothing that seemed to be too scary or too hard for these group of guys to do. Young guys, And one of the things that we would do is we did a lot of tree cutting. We ran a lot of chainsaws. And some of these guys that have never been around that, they would learn how to run a chainsaw for the first time on some of these trips. We would talk to their parents ahead of time. We wouldn't just say, hey, here's your nice 660 steel, going out and have fun. We would give the lowdown on how this thing worked. And there's one young man, his name was Neil. Neil grabbed onto that well. He is a phenomenal cutter, and we cut well a lot together. But I'll never forget, we were sitting in one section of woods, and there was one tree that had what we would call that widow maker. It's got that branch that's up at the top that's just kind of iffy if you don't know what direction it's going to fall because it's dead. You know what I'm talking about? So I said, well, here's the plan. You start cutting, and I'm going to stand out of the direct path. And if all you do is hear me yell my voice, what do? You run to me. So he puts on his chaps, he's got his helmet, he's got everything on, he starts it up, starts cutting, it starts vibrating enough that all I did was yell. He ran back and we watched the tree fall, the branch fall, everything was happy, safe, fell around where it needed to go. But the example was, as he was working, he was just simply listening in case something happened. James says when it comes to the word, just like the examples given, be quick. Be swift to hear. At the same time, be slow to speak. Be slow to speak. That is one of my biggest issues. I talk fast. It is probably a regular basis that I'm reminded, please, slow down. Slow down. And some of you are looking at me like, yeah, Dwayne, slow down. Because when you get going, it's just hard to listen. It's hard to hear. But when it talks about the word, it's the same concept. Be slow to speak. Would you do me a favor? Everybody look at one another. You're all pretty cool looking, eh? Anything you notice? Everybody here has two ears. I think. Some of you ladies have long hair. I don't know, but you know. At the same time, some of us might have enhanced hearing. I mean, come on, we got little digital things kind of sticking inside our ear canals. It's kind of nice. But we all have two ears. Does anybody here have more than one mouth? So a phrase that often is refreshed in our house, everybody has two ears and one mouth. You should listen twice as much as you speak. Be slow to speak. Proverbs 10 says this, he that refraineth his lips is wise. Proverbs 17, he that has knowledge and spares his words, you're not doing any good. When a wise man speaks, it may not be much, but it is well processed and thought out. Be slow to speak. Swift to hear, when it comes to the word, slow to speak. And another one that he gives us is this one. Be slow to anger or wrath, verse 19. Don't get mad at God or his word. Is it okay to ask God why, what, where, and when? Yes. I think God, as the Heavenly Father, delights in those situations. I love it when my children ask me questions. I love it when they say, how, when, what. Our Heavenly Father does too. It's okay to ask those, but be slow to anger, slow to wrath. Do not get mad at God or get mad at his word. King David, he was quick to anger when the prophet Nathan told him the story about the stolen lamb. Remember that story? And Nathan says, hey, this is what's going on. And David became very angry. He even pronounced a judgment in the midst of that story. And then the prophet turned around and he pointed his finger straight at Nathan, David, and said this, that you are that man. Peter was slow to hear and swift to speak, and he was swift to anger. In fact, he almost killed a guy with a sword. Fortunately, his aim was off and only got an ear. Can you imagine the response when Jesus just picked it up and just put it back on and rebuked Peter? Guys, this might be, for most of us, when it comes to tempers and short-fused. But it's geared towards all of us as well. A temper is a very valuable thing. It's a shame to lose it. A temper is a very valuable thing. It's a shame to lose it. So don't. So when it comes to receiving the word in the hearts and the soil, this is a way of preparing our hearts. James is picturing the heart as a garden. What happens to a garden when it's left to itself? Weeds, thorns, stones, clay, things start surfacing that is no good for the seed. So to prepare and get ready for the seed, what do we do with our hearts with that? How do we prepare our hearts? If our hearts are soil and the word of God is the seed, how do we prepare our hearts that? One, confessing sin. Seeking forgiveness. Confessing sin. Seeking forgiveness. Keeping that short sin list of what's going on. Want to prepare our hearts? What sin is in our life that we need to confess to and ask the Lord to forgive? Meditating on God's love and His grace. To prepare our hearts, what do? We meditate on God's love and God's grace. Maybe it's through music. Maybe it's through reading. Maybe it's just through the quiet moments of a beautiful scene of some sort being outside. But meditate on God's love and His grace. What's another way of preparing our hearts? Ask Him to plow out all that needs to be removed. What better way to ask for a heart prepared is to ask the Creator to plow out what needs to be plowed. The one that knows the very next word before we utter it off our lips. The one who knows the thought process before we do. The one who knows our innermost being. So we should ask Him to plow up everything in our hearts that needs to be removed as we get ready to receive the Word of God. And then receive the Word with meekness, which, by the way, is opposite of anger. Receive the Word in meekness. Don't argue with it. Honor it. Conform around the Word. Here's the danger. Sometimes we want to take the word and conform it around us. It's not the purpose of design. It's to conform around the word. So when it comes to the word of God and preparing our hearts and not deceiving ourselves, James says, receive the word. Next thing he says is practice the word. Okay? Verses 23 to 25, practice it. It's not enough just to hear the word. We have to do what it says. It's not enough just to hear the word. We have to do what it says. So who are the piano players in this place? Over here, over here. Okay. I always pick on Jack, so I'll bypass him today and I'll go to you. Okay? Ready? You play the piano a lot. I listen to it. You play it a lot, right? Okay, so this is a piano. How many keys are on this piano?
I think it might be 86,
but I'm not. 86, okay, very cool. You have a folder. Those are notes. I know that much. How do you know what note is what?
By where it's located.
By where it's located, okay? Sure. So I got one, two, three, is that five lines? Mm-hmm. Depends if I look at the bottom of my glasses or top of my glasses. So the third line from the bottom, there's a black note circling it. What is that?
Third line from the bottom.
Uh-huh.
That would be D if it's in the bass clef.
Oh.
That's impressive.
I guess there's 10 lines. Okay, what else do I need to know how to play this thing? So in other words, I just can't listen to what you're telling me and how to do this to learn to play this thing, right? How do I learn to play this thing?
Little by little.
Little by little. And what?
Practicing.
Practicing. In other words, it'd be more beneficial for me to sit and talk with you, to listen to what you have to say, to listen to your words, and then to what? Do what you say. We think about that in every other aspect of life. I will never be a great pianist. I promise. I'll listen to you, and I will listen to you play, and I will listen to what notes are what, and I know a little bit, but I don't know nothing. I will never be the pianist that you are if I don't do the work and the practice. Does that make sense? So when it comes to our hearts and not deceiving ourselves, when it comes to the word, we need to do what it says. It's not enough just to hear it. Many people mistakenly believe that hearing a good sermon or listening to a good Bible study or a good program or watching a new thing on Right Now Media or whatever, listening to things, think that that's how they're going to grow and get God's blessings. Those in themselves are a great thing. They really are. And they are needed and useful tools. But doing what it says is what brings the blessings and the growth. That's where the blessings come from. Doing what it says. And James is very clear about that. Do not just be a listener, but be a doer of the word. We started this section comparing the word of God to seed and how James draws our attention to a mirror. So in doing what it says, the first thing this mirror does is it examines. Verses 23 to 25. This is the main reason to own a mirror. To examine. To look what you look like before you step outside the doors. Some of us really don't care a whole lot. None of you, I'm sure. A mirror. Being able to see myself. Making sure that what? I am clean, neat, and properly put together. There is no way you would... The way my hair was this morning and the little goop in my eyes and the thing and the unshaved me. If I would have showed up this morning looking like that, you would have thought something was terribly wrong. You look. You examine. See that you're neat. You're put together. But looking to the mirror, the Word of God shows us who we really are. So when we do take a look, there are some common mistakes that we won't dare make in everyday life, but we often make when it comes to the Word. In other words, I just merely glance. I don't really study or look into it deeply. I just merely glance. And then I turn and walk away. Oftentimes, that's just duty. Okay, Dwayne says I got to look into my Bible as a mirror. Seen it. Let's go. Check off that box. Right? That becomes just a duty. Clear the list. Check the box. Just merely glance. Or another common mistake is I look at it and I read it, but then when I turn away and go away, I forget what I see. I forget what I looked at. I forget what I read. I forget. I just kind of like, okay, squirrel, gone. Now it happens. Have you ever walked into a room and got there and realized, why did I come in here? So then you go back to where you started to figure out what you're doing, get it. Oh, that's what I want to go get. And then you go back and get it done. Okay. Same thing. Don't look at it and just forget what we see. If we are looking deeply into the heart, what we would see would be unforgettable. If we were looking deeply into the heart, what we would see would be unforgettable. And then as James pulls out again, just forget to do what it says or fail to do what it says. It becomes too common to replace the reading of the word with doing. Or talking about the word and then doing. The doing is what brings the blessing. After seeing ourselves, we must remember what we are and what God says. Then we must do something about it. Don't just walk away and forget. James even says it here, the perfect law of liberty. Why? Because if we obey it, God sets us free. He sets us free. So receive the word, practice the word, and And now share the word. Share the word, verses 26 to 27. In fact, the word religion translates as this, an outward practice or a service of God. It is used 5 times throughout the New Testament, and oftentimes it is cross-referenced with the word worship or worshiping. Share the word. James brings up some areas on how we share it. What are some avenues that we can share the word with? Verse 26, with our speech. There are so many references to the tongue in this letter, which also indicates that there was problems with the tongue in the church. But in our speech, the tongue reveals the heart, according to Matthew 12. The tongue reveals the heart. If the heart is right, the speech will be right. What goes on in here will oftentimes come out of here. So if the heart is right, the tongue is right. A controlled tongue means a controlled body. A controlled body is a controlled heart, James chapter 3. So share the word, what? With our speech. How many of you want to preach next Sunday morning? We're going to start James chapter 2. Okay. Lord willing, I will be here. Unless he calls us home for the rapture or whatever the case may be. So this is not the avenue that God's placed you in this moment in time. But guess what? How many people do you know that don't know Christ, that you have conversations with on a semi-regular basis? How many people are you going to talk to tomorrow? Use your speech. Does that mean that you're bringing up the gospel in every conversation? No, because oftentimes our speech needs to grab that relationship and it brings into a lifestyle, it brings into so much more. But our speech can also be what turns people totally away. Does that make sense? Share the word in speech. Verse 27 talks about it in service as well. As we see ourselves in the mirror of God's word, we then look to the needs of others. What I see going on in my life then allows me to turn around and invest in other people, to help meet the needs of other people. There are circumstances and things that have happened in the life of Dwayne and Charlotte and the Burna family that God, after a lot of time, can then turn around and use investing into others. Why? Because we can say with all sincerity, we understand what you're thinking and what you're feeling right now, but let me tell you what God is able to do. God brings us through hard times. God brings you through hard times for service. Would God ever take you through something extremely hard or extremely low to expect you to get through and then turn around and just be the same person? No. No, he wouldn't. It's for service. Words are no substitute for the works of love. God doesn't want us to just simply speak. He wants us to do the service. Another scenario, God doesn't just want us to pay others to minister as a substitute for our own personal service. Now, there are some circumstances that God may call you to go do something and you have the physical ability and the resources to do so, and that's an amazing thing. Go and do. If God calls you to invest in somebody's life, do. If God calls you to go work for somebody and invest in them in that way, go do. God calls you to do, I mean, whatever the circumstance is, God calls you for that, go and do. Phenomenal. But there are also times that God may call you to say, hey, you know what? You can't physically go do right now, but you can definitely invest in the ones that go do. In other words, some of the guys that we would go out on these trips or these teams, we would take all over the place and work and invest and do the ministry. Some of our guys, they couldn't do that. So what they do? They would say, hey, I'm going to financially send you to do that. For instance, you have missionaries on the board right out there that you support financially to do the work, the ministry that God has placed in their lives to do. Is that correct? And that's a needed thing. They need a base. There are times that God calls us to pay or to invest financially so that they can do the work of the ministry. But don't think that eliminates the personal responsibility that we have to do the service as well. It might not be in Peru, but it might be in Napanee. It might be at work. It might be at school. It might be whatever location God has placed you in. That is where you serve. James also calls us, in order to share the word, there's got to be a separation from the world. Verse 27. The world here is meaning a society without God. The standard. The philosophy. I mean, remember, Satan is the prince and power of this world. John 14 states that. And the lost are the children of this world. Luke 16 states that. But as children of God, as believers, as the church, we are in this world physically, but we are not of it spiritually. We have to be sent into the world to win others to Christ. And it's through our separation of the world that keeps us able to serve others. Does that make sense? We are in this world, but we are not of it. We don't friend the world being defined as the godless society, but we find ourselves with people that don't know God in order to invest in them to know the Lord. The world wants to spot or dirty the Christian and defile them. How? Because that world, being that society without God, if we get a friendship with that society without God, we start building a friendship with that kind of mentality, that thinking. Because, I mean, honestly, sometimes it does seem like the man who doesn't have any biblical care whatsoever seems to prosper. Can't we see that? It's okay to step on who you need to step on to get to where you want to go. And it seems to work. But don't friend that type of society. Don't friend that type of world. James 4 says, because if you do, that can lead to a love for that kind of world, that kind of society. And if we're not careful, we can then be conformed to that world, Romans chapter 12 says. So if we love, become a friend of this world, and then we start conforming to this world, what's the result? The results being condemned with the world. Now, I'm not suggesting the fact of a loss of salvation. Not at all. But rather losing everything the believer has worked for. We're losing everything that we have lived for. One of the sayings about heaven is that there are not going to be any more crying. But there is a part where we read that Jesus will be the one to wipe the tears from our eyes. You know, I believe that's going to be when, as believers, we stand before God and give an account. And give an account for the actions that we have. To give an account for the opportunities to give an account for the words that we spoke, or to give an account for the preferences that we've chosen. It's not about losing our salvation. Again, what's our salvation based upon? It's based upon Jesus Christ, the cross, the derelict resurrection. Our salvation is based upon Him, not our works. Our works are a fruit of salvation, but not the basis for our salvation. He is powerful enough, He is mighty enough, He is strong enough to call Him to Himself and call us saved. He has done all the work. We submit and obey to Him. But the opportunities that He brings into our lives, or the places that He has placed you and I in order to build and to grow, and the people He has chosen for us to live for, if you become a friend or a lover of this world system, you lose that. You can't love and live for this world system and say that you love God. Does that make sense? So we need to be separate from the world, yet in it. It is not necessary for a Christian to get involved with the world to have a ministry. Jesus was unspotted, and yet, what do we know? He was a friend of sinners. He was a friend of the tax collector. He called Zacchaeus to get out of a tree to spend time with Him. He loved the sinner, but He hated the sin. Do you love the sinner and hate the sin? Or the world that has a godless mentality, a godless system? The best way to minister to the needs of the world, James says, is to be pure from the defilement of the word, of the world. So set up your guard. He gives us practicalities. What are those practicalities that He gives us in this particular passage? To visit the orphans and the widows in their trouble, and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Keep your unself unspotted from the world. Do not be a friend, a lover, or conform to this world system. Keep yourself unspotted. Set up your guard. And start by not deceiving yourself. Deceiving yourself or your heart. So receive the word. Practice the word. Share the word. That's the challenge that James has for us this morning. We pray for us together as we close. Father, we thank You so much for this section of the letter. We thank You, Lord, for the challenge that we have received when it comes to Your word. To cultivate, to have our hearts ready to receive it, but then to do what it says. And in doing what it says, ministering to the needs of others, Lord, cause us to be a picture of who You are and what You've done for us. May our love for You and the salvation that You've given be a reflection on the way that we live and treat others in the place that You've called us to be, even this week. Lord, use us in some pretty amazing ways this week. It's Your precious name we do pray. Amen.
We close this morning. How are we going to do this? By trusting in Jesus. Join us, please. Ooh.
I'm going to help me with the closing verse as we get out of here. You ready? But we're going to do it fun. It's not going to be in English. I know how many bilingual people are in here. You guys speak so many languages, don't you? All right, repeat after me. You ready? Hine.
Hine.
Matov.
Matov.
Umanayim.
Umanayim.
You're doing great. Shevet.
Shevet.
Not Shevet. Shevet.
Shevet.
Achim.
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 Gam Yachad.
Gam Yachad.
Okay, ready? Got it? Hine Matov. Shevet Achim.
Gam Yachad.
How good and how pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity. Receive the word.